Welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church in Sacramento, California. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Terrell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message, and that you'll share it with a friend. The root of bitterness is one of the deadliest weapons in the devil's arsenal, and most Christians aren't even aware of it. Bitterness will hinder you from coming boldly to the throne of God, and harboring it will make you a slave to anger, resentment, jealousy, rebellion, contempt, and give you a desire for revenge. Pastor John shares how he has struggled with bitterness and how hidden anger would flare up every now and then when certain things happened. He attributed it to frustration and being tired but neglected this area of his life because he thought he was fine. This sermon is a testimony of what God has done in Pastor John's life and how bitterness can enter your life and make you incapable of unconditional love. This message is entitled, The Root of Bitterness. Now, let's go to the sanctuary and join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord, and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church on March 27, 2011. And I'm glad you're here today. I'm glad I'm here. I attended a funeral Saturday with my wife, and it was a sad situation. And as I saw the body laying in the coffin, it had an open coffin, I realized I am blessed that I'm still alive. You know why I'm blessed? Because I can still be part of God's work on this earth. This man is in heaven. He's finished. He's rejoicing. But I like to be part. I like to fight a little bit more. I'm not done yet. Let's stand for prayer. My Heavenly Father, I want to thank and I praise you right now that, Lord, we can meet here on this Sunday morning. And Father God, look into your word. And I pray right now, today, Father God, just move mightily. Let your Holy Spirit not only anoint me, Lord, but anoint every person listening. And I praise you for that now. And I bless you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You may be seated. I'm going to start off with a bonus scripture. Revelation chapter 3. That's Revelation, the third chapter. And we're going to pick it up in verse number 15. Actually, let me start from number 14. Revelation 3, 14. And unto the angel of the church of Laodiceans write, these things is the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know your works, that you are neither cold nor hot. I would you were cold or hot. So then, because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew you out of my mouth. Because you say, I am rich and increased with goods, have need of nothing, and knowest not that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that you may be rich, and white raiment that you may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness do not appear. And anoint your eyes with eye salve, that you may see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten, and be zealous, therefore, and repent. Now, I've read that scripture many times. I'm sure you have read it many times. And I never thought about maybe this will apply to myself. I never thought about that. I thought of myself as a hot potato. You know, just on fire for the Lord. And I want you today to really think about this. Could this apply to you? I'm speaking today about the root of bitterness. The root of bitterness. Listen to what Jesus said in verse number 20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him, and he with me. Now, are you hot or are you cold or lukewarm? Well, you might say, you know, this is what I said over the years, you know, that I'm going to church, I'm reading the Bible, I pray, I witness, I lead people to Christ, and all kind of things. I'm sure I am hot. But then I realized that the root of bitterness is such a nasty, nasty plant. And it's just like cancer. When first the cancer cell develops, you don't feel it. And the cancer grows and grows, and you don't feel it. Until it's grown to the place that you got a large tumor, and it begins to kill off other organs in your body, then suddenly pain shows up. And they discover you got cancer. But you see, you might have cancer, you might have that for 5 years or 10 years. The root of bitterness is hard to detect to begin with. You don't see it until it begins to manifest in a cancerous spiritual tumor. Let me read from my outline right now. In the Message, Wounds That Hurt Your Soul, I established that the soul is very sensitive and can easily be hurt. If hurts are not dealt with, the wound will fester and create strong feelings that will express themselves in anger, bitterness, and resentment. Now, when we get bitter and angry, or we have resentment, we don't know where it comes from. We just feel it. Now, let's turn to Hebrews chapter 12. That's Hebrews, the 12th chapter. And today I'm preaching to the choir. Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 14. Follow peace with all men. I'm sure you read that. What does that mean? That means that you're not angry with anyone. It means that you had peace, that you don't have anyone that you have problems with. Follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. And if you have the root of bitterness, it will defile you. It will cause disease and sickness and other things. So let's now try to identify the root of bitterness. And we begin with the downfall of Cain. And we start in the very beginning, Genesis chapter 4. And let me just read it from the outline here, that Cain was the first man to be born. His parents were created. And that's unique. Nothing is spoken of his childhood. His younger Abel, brother Abel, was the second one to be born. They had different vocations as they became adults. Cain became a farmer while Abel became a sheep herder. Nothing is said in the Bible about their relationship. We don't know anything. Trouble began when these two brothers were going to worship the Lord and bring an offering. Cain brought a fruit offering, while Abel brought a blood sacrifice. And God rejected Cain's offering and accepted Abel's blood sacrifice. Genesis chapter 4, the first four verses. And Adam knew his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I've gotten a man for the Lord. And she again bare his brother Abel. And Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought out the fruit of the ground, an offering of the Lord. And Abel, he also brought out the firstlings of the flock, and of the fat thereof. And the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering. But unto Cain and his offering, he had no respect. And Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. Let's look upon this now. They have been instructed, I want a blood sacrifice. And you find in Genesis 3:21 that God killed two animals or more animals and made skins, clothing for Adam and Eve, so that was a blood sacrifice. And if you turn to Leviticus chapter 17, that's Leviticus, the 17th chapter. We read this from verse number 11. For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I've given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls. For it's the blood that makes an atonement for the soul. Cain said, I'm going to give you a fruit offering. Now, be happy, God. Sit down, shut up, and bless me. He was very defiant. And in Hebrews 9:22, that's Hebrews chapter 9, verse number 22, we read this. And almost all things about law, by the law purged with blood, and without shedding of blood, is no remission. Now Cain wanted it his way. And God simply said, I would not accept it. I want you to look at the box now that we got written here, in the outline. And if you're watching this video, if you don't have an outline, just go to the home page, look up what the sermon is, and to your right, this is outlines. You can print out the outline in English, Swedish, German, Spanish, four languages. But listen to this now, what I wrote. Cain became angry with God. And instead of accepting responsibility for his own disobedience, he hardened his heart and created a huge wound in his soul. Every one of us that are here, that are watching, you have failed in life. I have never met the person, the man or woman yet, that simply said this, from the time I was a baby and all the way up to now, I have only had success. I've been successful in all things. I never made a mistake. And I'm perfect and I have a fantastic life. People like that do not exist. If they do exist, if they say they exist, they are lying. Every one of us have failed ourselves. It could be as a child, in school, relationship, whatever it is. You and I made decisions that were not good, turned out to be a disaster, and then we got angry. And we got angry over our defeat. And that anger created a huge wound in the soul. Now we got spiritual cancer. And that wound is not going to go away. It has to project itself somewhere towards someone. Now then I wrote this. Cain refused to repent. Even though God talked to him and cared for him. Look at verses 6 and 7 there. And the Lord said unto Cain, why are you wroth? He was not angry. He was madder than the hornet. It's another term, but I'm going to use it in church. And why is your countenance fallen? If you do well, shall you not be accepted? And if you do not well, sin lies at the door. And unto you shall be its desire, and you shall rule over it. Now, this is what the Hebrew text here says. So God simply spoke to Cain and said, look, Cain, if you do well, I forgive you. Start over. Give me another sacrifice. But Cain dug in his heels. He said this, it's my way or the highway. It's my way. I'm rebelling. I don't like that you are God over me. If you want a sacrifice, you take what I give you. His anger had created such a wound that he had to take it out on someone. Look at the next statement there. Cain's wrath was directed at God. He was angry with God. But he could not take it out on God. Instead, his soul wound became so infested that he transferred his wrath to his brother Abel. Verse 8. And Cain talked with Abel, his brother. And it came to pass when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and slew him. I want you to see in your mind these two men walking. Abel, innocent, loving God, feeling good. His brother just boiling with anger, wrath. And he said, okay, God, if you're not going to accept my offering, if you cannot accept my offering, I'm going to destroy the man that you love. I'm going to kill him. Because God, I'm upset. I'm not going to change. And in anger, he murdered his brother. How many people over the years, you have not murdered anyone, but how many people over the years have you wounded, attacked, rebelled against because you had a wound, you had a root of bitterness in your soul? Now, you know, we pray when we could do deliverance for breaking curses for ourselves and so on. But have you ever thought about breaking the curses that you have spoken against others? Hurts that you have inflicted on other people. We're getting close to home now. I think that every one of us, we're going to say, well, I got a few skeletons in my closet. When he was confronted by God for Abel's murder, Cain showed no remorse or repentance. He was only concerned about his own well-being. Look at verses 9 through 14. And the Lord said to Cain, where is Abel, your brother? And he said, I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper? What a lie. And he said, what have you done? The voice of your brother's blood cries unto me from the ground. And now are you cursed from the earth, which has opened a mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you till the ground, it shall henceforth yield unto you. It shall not henceforth yield unto you her strength. A fugitive and a vagabond shall you be in the earth. Look at the answer now in verse 13. And Cain said unto the Lord, my punishment is greater than I can bear. Instead of saying, my heavenly Father, I have sinned. I'm guilty. Can you forgive me? He didn't do that. And this is what happened. Many people had a root of bitterness. We don't repent. We don't seek forgiveness. We simply just move on. And we say, I can't bear this. Behold, you have driven me out this day from the face of the earth, and from your face shall I be hid. I shall be a fugitive and a vagabond in the earth. It shall come to pass that everyone that finds me shall slay me. All Cain could think about was me, myself, and I. The root of bitterness had completely saturated his soul. And he left the presence of the Lord, never again to return to the Lord, even through God in his mercy had set the protection for him. Verses 15 through 16. And the Lord said to him, therefore whosoever slays Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold. And the Lord set a mark upon Cain, lest the defiling should kill him. And Cain went out from the presence of the Lord, and dwelt in the land of Nod, on the east of Eden. I want you to hear and see verse number 16. And Cain went out from the presence of the Lord. When you and I sin, the last thing we want to do is to walk away from the presence of the Lord. That's a time when we want to repent. And if you have a hardened heart, an anger in yourself, then you need to simply say the root of bitterness has to go. Cain lived a life as an evil man who was bitter, angry, resentful, hateful to God. And this passed on to his offspring. And they became cursed and destructive. Verse 17 through 24, we read this. And Cain knew his wife, and she conceived and bare Enoch. This is not the Enoch that the Bible talks about. And he built a city and called the name of the city after the name of his son Enoch. And to Enoch was born Irad. Irad begat Mehuyahel. And Mehuyahel begat Methusel. And Methuselah beget Lamech. That's not the Lamech of the lineage that we have in the Bible either. These are evil men. And Lamech took unto him two wives. The name of one was Ada, and the name of the other, Zillah. And Ada bare Jabal. He was the father of such a dwelling tents of such of cattle. And his brother's name was Jubal. He was the father of all such a handle of harp and organ. And Zillah, she also bare Tubal-Cain, an instructor of every artificer in brass and iron. And the sister of Tubal-Cain was Naama. And Lamech sent to his wives, Ada and Zillah, hear my voice, you wives of Lamech. Hearken to my speech, for I have slain a man to my wounding and a young man to my hurt. Murder continued in the family. When the flood came, all of Cain's descendants died. Let me now go through this one more time with you. Cain rebelled against God, caused a self-inflicted wound. His soul was wounded. His anger was rising. And instead of repenting, he took it out on his brother Abel and killed him. And Cain cursed his entire line of descendants. And Cain, when he sinned, I really try to bring this home now. The moment Cain came with a fruit offering and sacrificed that, he sacrificed all his descendants because all of them went to hell. All of them will spend eternity in the lake of fire. When did he do it? When he sacrificed the fruit. You and I need to look in our own lives and say, Father, my Heavenly Father, what kind of actions have I taken over the years that can have caused a root of bitterness in my soul? Because I believe this, I know this, that most people here and watching, you have a problem with anger, resentment, and bitterness. It's rampant. And it might not be in all areas. It might be that you have it in just a small area. But it means that the cancer has started. Look at my box now. If a person has been wounded by parents, siblings, or a spouse, the soul will become angry, and since it cannot retaliate and vent its anger on the people that caused the wound, the soul will project the anger on new people who had nothing to do with the wounding. This is why we have so many divorces. Because you have two people getting married. They're bringing in themselves as a soul damage. And instead of dealing with the baggage you had from the past, they take it out on the current spouse. And the current spouse simply says, well, I can understand. Why is this coming on me? Well, the soul is wounded. The soul is angry. And the soul is going to take it out on the people around you. If you have problems, stop and simply say, in the name of Jesus, these people have nothing to do with my problems in the past. I have to deal with my past, not project it on people today. Where does the root of bitterness come from? The root of bitterness comes from the wounding of the soul by parents or other people. Abraham and Sarah became terrible parents to their son Ishmael, whom Sarah conceived in unbelief and sin toward God. Turn to Genesis chapter 16. That's Genesis chapter 16. You read from verse number 1. Now Sarai, Abraham's wife, bare him no children. And she had a handmaid, an Egyptian, whose name was Hagar. And Sarah said to Abraham, behold, now the Lord has restrained me from bearing. I pray you, go into my maid, it may be that I may obtain children by her. And Abraham hearkened to the voice of Sarah. God has said, Sarah is going to get pregnant. It didn't happen. They had waited for 20 years. And then Sarah simply said this, look, I'm getting older. Get me pregnant. I can't get pregnant. Get this woman, get her pregnant. Let us get a child. Let's help out God. And when he went to Hagar, she conceived, and when she said she conceived, her mistress was despised of eyes. And Sarah said to Abraham, my wrong be upon you. I have given my maid into your bosom, and when she saw that she conceived, I was despised in her eyes. The Lord judge between me and you. Anytime you start something that God did not tell you to do, there's going to be problems. But Abraham said to Sarah, behold, the maid is in your hand. Do as you please to her. And when Sarah dealt hardly with her, she fled from her face. Now, in verse number 10, we read this. And the angel of the Lord sent to her, and unto Hagar now, I will multiply your seed exceedingly, that it shall not be numbered for multitude. And the angel of the Lord said to her, behold, you are with child, shall bear a son, shall call his name Ishmael, because the Lord heard your affliction. He will be a wild man. His hand will be against every man, and every man's hand against him, and he shall dwell in the presence of his brethren. Now, here's a prophetic word. Ishmael is going to be a wild man. Picture Ishmael now. He's born. He sees Abraham. That's his dad. He sees Sarah. She doesn't like him. She must have been hate coming out from her. And Ishmael must have said, you know, when he was 3 or 4 or 5 years old, now what have I done? Why is she angry with me? I haven't done anything. His soul was wounded and wounded and wounded. Finally, Sarah simply said, get him out of here. And Abraham drove them out and sent them away. Now, if you have been rejected by your father, that creates a huge damage in your soul. If you've been rejected by your mother, it's just as bad. And Ishmael now became an angry man, the root of bitterness. And if you look upon the nations right now in the Middle East, there you have the descendants of Ishmael. And if you ever dealt with people from that region, and I'm not a racist, but if you look upon people from Iran, from Iraq, Jordan, Syria, Lebanon, you really can't trust them. They are angry people. They don't like themselves. They fight terrible. They kill, they maim. God said, he shall be a wild man. 4,000 years later, his descendants are wild men. They need Jesus. Only Jesus can clean up the Middle East. Here's what I wrote. Ishmael had 12 sons who became 12 princes, and he established 12 different nations. One of them was the Canaanites. These nations became steeped in idol worship, whoredom, child sacrifices. The root of bitterness is still among the descendants in the Middle East, even after more than 4,000 years. What can you and I learn from this? We need to learn and simply say, Lord, am I lukewarm? Do I have a root of bitterness? Turn to 1 Samuel chapter 9. Now, we're going to skip that one scripture in Genesis 25, 12 through 18. I'll have to read it yourself. But turn me right now to 1 Samuel. It's 1 Samuel chapter 9. The root of bitterness also comes from the rebellion and self-inflicted wounds of the soul. As a young man, Saul had everything going for him. He had a great father, and the future looked bright. If you read these two verses, now there was a man of Benjamin, whose name was Kish, the son of Abel, the son of Zerah, the son of Behurath, the son of Aphiah, a Benjamite, a mighty man of power. And yet his son, whose name was Saul, a choice young man, and a goodly man, and a godly man. And there was not among the children of Israel a godlier person than he. From his shoulders upward, he was higher than any other people. Now Saul started out right. He had a good dad, good mom, good background. But this root of bitterness came upon him. In verse 15 through 19 in the same chapter, we read this. Now the Lord had told Samuel in his ear a day before, Saul came saying, tomorrow about this time I will send you a man of the land of Benjamin. You shall anoint him to be captain of my people Israel, that he might save my people out of the hand of the Philistines. For I have looked upon my people, because their cry is coming to me. And when Samuel saw Saul, the Lord said to him, behold, the man whom I speak to you of, the same shall reign over my people. In chapter 10, verse number 1, we read this. That's 10:1. Then Samuel took a vial of oil, poured it upon his head, kissed him and said, "Is it not because the Lord has anointed me captain over his inheritance?" Saul now had a right childhood. He got anointed. And the future was bright. But you see, Saul decided, just like Cain, to disobey the word of the Lord. And we read now from 1 Samuel chapter 13. 1 Samuel chapter 13. And we want to pick it up in verses 5 through 9. And the Philistines gathered themselves together to fight with Israel, 30,000 chariots, 6,000 horsemen, and people as a sand which is at the seashore in the multitude. And they came up and pitched in Michmash, eastward from Beth Aven. When the men of Israel saw they were in a strait, for the people were distressed, then the people did hide themselves in the caves and in thickets, and in rocks and high places and in pits. And some of the Hebrews went over Jordan to the land of Gad and Gilead. As for Saul, he was yet in Gilgal, and all the people followed him, trembling. And he tarried 7 days and couldn't set time that Samuel appointed. But Samuel came to Gilgal, and the people were scattered from him. Here was the situation now. He was told, "You wait 7 days until I show up." He had a whole bunch of people desert. The people that had with him were scared to death. The Philistines were there. And after 7 days, Saul simply said this, "This is not going down right. I'm going to take this in my own hands." And Saul said, "Bring here a burnt offering to me and peace offerings." And he offered the burnt offering. Now, he disobeyed God. And when he disobeyed God, it cost him. And we read this in verse 11. And Samuel said, "What have you done?" And Saul said, "Because I saw the people scattered from me, that you came not within the days appointed. The Philistine gathered himself together at Michmash. Therefore," said I, "the Philistine will come down upon me to Gilgal. I have not made supplication to the Lord. I forced myself therefore and offered a burnt offering." And Samuel said to Saul, "You have done foolishly. You have not kept the commandment of the Lord your God, which he commanded you. For now would the Lord have established your kingdom upon Israel forever. But now your kingdom shall be not continue. For the Lord has sought after a man of his own heart, and the Lord has commanded him to be captain over his people, because you have not kept that which the Lord commanded you." Self-inflicted wound now. How do you think Saul felt after this? Angry. He was wounded now. Okay, I lost my kingdom. You know, I can't understand this. I was standing on a mountain. I got all the Philistines around me. I got all these things. I just couldn't help myself. God, what do you want me to do? "Be still and know I'm God. Trust in the Lord." He couldn't do that. He became very, very angry. Turn to 1 Samuel 18 now. And I want to show you how this anger now was directed. He had a root of bitterness. It's a bad one. Excuse me, I want to go down. And I want to read here from verse. Let me read from verse 1. "And it came to pass when he had made an end of speaking unto Saul, that the soul of Jonathan was knit with the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul. And Saul took him that day and would let him not go more to his father's house. Then Jonathan and David made a covenant, because he loved him as his own soul. And Jonathan stripped himself of the robe which was on him, gave it to David, his garment even to his sword, and to his bow and to his girdle. And David went out whithersoever Saul sent him, and behaved himself wisely. And Saul set him over the men of war. He was accepted in the sight of all the people, also in the sight of all Saul's servant. And it came to pass, when David was returned from the slaughter of Philistines, the women came out of all the city of Israel, singing and dancing, to meet King Saul with tabrets, with joy, and with instruments of music. And the women answered one another as they played and said, Saul has slain his thousands, and David his 10,000s. And Saul was very wroth, and his saying displeased him. And he said, he has described to David 10,000s, and to me they have ascribed but thousands. And what can he have more but the kingdom? And Saul eyed David from that day and forward. Notice now, the wound was increasing. We now had a cancer tumor, a spiritual cancer tumor. In verse 10, and it came to pass on the morrow that the evil spirit from God, now this was God allowing this evil spirit, that an evil spirit from God came upon Saul. And he prostrated in the midst of the house, and David played with his hand at all the times. And there was a javelin in Saul's hand. And Saul cast the javelin, for he said, I will smite David even to the wall with it. And David avoided out of his presence twice. And Saul was afraid of David, because the Lord was with him, and was departed from Saul. You get angry, you get a wound, and that wound now is festering. Evil spirit will come in. And Saul now had the same type of spirit that Cain had, murder. If I can't have it my way, I'm going to kill anyone standing in my way. He was very wounded. Did not repent. As a result, he later died. His descendants died with him. And the house of Saul is no more. Now, some of you have been delivered. Something has come up afterwards, or some things were not dealt with. And because of the root of bitterness, new demons have come in and taking a hold. And you're trying to walk with the Lord, but you have a hard time to worship the Lord, hard time to pray, hard time to be at peace. You are angry. That is a sign of spiritual cancer, the root of bitterness. Look what I wrote here at the bottom of page 2. You cannot love with a wounded soul. If you have a wounded soul, you cannot love. There are several words for love in the Greek language. Eros is sensual, sexual love. Phileo is brotherly love. Agape is divine love. Philo is wishing love, like I would love to have that. I would love to have some ice cream. Now, you cannot love someone with the agape love as long as there is a root of bitterness. Nor can you love them with filial love. I'm going to take it to bonus scripture here. This is Romans chapter 5. I'm going to deviate just a little bit here. Romans, the 5th chapter. And I want to read from verse number 6. For when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commands his love toward us, in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. What does that mean? It means when you and I were ugly, in our sins, terrible, God said, I love you. And if you repent, I will forgive you. If you have people around you that you cannot stand, and you simply say, well, I've forgiven them, but I can't stand them, you do not have the Spirit of Jesus in you. Because Jesus, while we were yet sinners, died for us. If we have the Spirit of Jesus, that's the Holy Spirit. If you have the Holy Spirit, we will have compassion on people, not having any anger. And if you have anger and you cannot have compassion on certain people, you have the root of bitterness. If there are people that have hurt you so deeply that you do not want to see them, you have not truly forgiven them, and still have a root of bitterness in your soul, turn to Romans 12, 17. That's Romans 12, 17. Let me say this to you. If you cannot say, I am sorry, I want to repent, forgive me, you had a root of bitterness. There's a lot of people that are hard. Mom and dad never showed them how to repent. They don't repent. You have a spirit, the root of bitterness. To be free, we got to forgive. In Romans chapter 12, verse number 17, we read this. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lies in you, live peaceable with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourself, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. Therefore, if your enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, you shall heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. This goes against everything that we are made of in our rebellious spirits, souls we have. You know, somebody hurts us, you know, we just feel, you know, I want to plow back and just hit them as hard as possible. Vengeance, revenge. But you see, if you really are going to progress, now I'm speaking normally in the church, they don't talk about things like this. They don't go down deep with the biblical thing. They simply say, hey, you know, life is good, sun is shining, you're going to get money tomorrow, let's have a good time, praise God, there's no evil in the world, just feel good. But Jesus wants to purify us on this side of eternity. He wants to plow to go deeper. You might attend and hold position in the church, witness and do all kinds of things for God, but they are done in the flesh because of the root of bitterness. Those are harsh words. But you know, for many years I did a lot of things in the flesh. Because I had the root of bitterness. I was angry. Some people I just couldn't forgive. Until God dealt with me. And you see, when you get rid of the root of bitterness, you sleep better. You don't have the people for breakfast, lunch, dinner. When you go on vacation, you take them with you in the back seat. They just evaporate. You don't have to worry about them anymore. They're gone. Forgiven. Turn to 1 John chapter 4. That's 1 John chapter 4. These are powerful verses. John, 1 John 4. We picked them up here at verse number 7. Beloved, let us hate one another. Is that what the Bible says? You know the word love here is agape, not eros. Beloved, as a love one another. For love is of God, and everyone that loves is born of God and knows God. You know, if you had a root of bitterness in you, you cannot receive love from somebody else. If somebody tried to give you a gift, you can't receive it. If somebody tried to be nice to you, you say to them, well, what do they want? If you cannot receive love, you got a root of bitterness in you. We got to give and we got to receive. Beloved, let's love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loves is born of God and knows God. He that loves not knows not God, for God is love. And this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. And then drop down to verse number 17. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There's no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear has torment. He that fears is not made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. If a man say, I love God, hates his brother, he's a liar. For he that loves not his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? And this commandment have you from him, that he who loves God, love his brother also. Now the root of bitterness can be taken out. And the remedy is the blood of Jesus. When you come to God and say, my Heavenly Father, I want to confess to you, these are sins in my life. Please forgive me. Here comes now the blood of Jesus. And just washes you white as snow. And then comes the Holy Spirit and puts in his love. And suddenly, instead of anger and bitterness and resentment, you just have a love. The sun is brighter. The bird sings greater. It looks nicer outside. Things are changed on the inside. Having the root of bitterness is a sin. It will make you a slave to anger, resentment, or desire for revenge, jealousy, rebellion, and contempt. Turn to Romans 6:12. It's Romans chapter 6, verse number 12. All of us have had people do us wrong. We have been shafted, lied about, hurt over the years. Let it go. Romans 6, verse 12. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the lust thereof. Neither yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourself unto God, those that are alive for the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For sin should not have dominion over you, for you're not under the law, but under grace. What then shall be sin because we are not under the law, but the grace, God forbid? Know you not that to whom you yield yourself servants or slaves to obey, his slaves you are to whom you obey, whether sin unto death or obedience unto righteousness. You don't want to be a slave. In my life, I'm not going to take the time right now, but I can go back to my childhood and all the way up through today. And I can give you a parade of people that have hurt me, done me wrong, that I have done nothing wrong to them. And they hurt me deeply, destroyed many things in our lives. But I learned this, and it really works. Now, I'm a fighter. I was a fighter to begin with. I'm still a fighter. but I fight now with the Lord's help. And it used to be that I would try to get even. But I learned this. When somebody hurt me, I simply turn them over to God. And I said, God, I forgive that person. I just release him or her right now. I let God deal with it. Mine is, God said that mine is a revenge. I will recompense. I will revenge. Not me. And you know what? It keeps my spirit sweet. I don't have bitter. I can meet those people today and I have no feel nothing in my heart. I feel sorry for them. Closing scripture, 1 Corinthians chapter 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. We pick it up in verse number 28. We usually read this for Lord's Supper, but it also applies to us today. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eats and drinks unworthily, eats and drinks damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. What a privilege! God is saying this, you judge yourself and ask for forgiveness, and I don't have to judge you. When you're judged, you're chasing the Lord, and you should not be condemned with the word, with the world. Wherefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, to take the Lord's Supper, tarry, wait for one another. We have always an altar call at Resurrection Life of Jesus Church. And this is a time where you can come and say, pray for me, anoint me with oil. Now I notice that this in the congregation, we have three different people up here. Sometimes we have more people, we have four. But there's someone up that I might be standing here and you says, well, you know, I don't care for that person. I would never be able to go to that person and be prayed for. Listen to me now. I'm talking to you. If you in your heart simply say this, when there's an invitation and anyone standing up here and you say in your heart, I will never go to that person, you have the root of bitterness. And it will destroy you. It's eating on you. When we have our altar call today, if that's the case, no one is going to know what you're doing. But you need to go to that person and say, look, I have this against you. I'm angry. Can you forgive me? Can you pray about this? And you will go home tonight, not tonight, but this afternoon. You will go home rejoicing. You will have left all the baggage right here at the altar. If you do that. But you know what? So many people have it on the spirit. Hear what I'm saying now. The spirit of pride. That's a demon. I don't want anyone to know that. I don't want anyone to see I'm going forward. I don't want to show them that I have problems. Pride! Making you sick. If you have someone today, you say, well, I need to be prayed for. Use the time of the altar call. Don't harden your heart. Because if you do, that root of bitterness will put out a plant that will be a bush and a tree. And it will put you in an early grave. Let's stand for prayer. My Heavenly Father, I ask you today, Lord, that you will heal our church. Father God, you know that among ourselves, we are not always loving certain people, Lord. We have some people, we says, well, I can't stand that person. I'm sad he's in the church, but that's the way it is. Father God, we need a healing there. Holy Spirit, right now, soften our hearts. Soften our hearts, Lord. We don't want to be like Cain or Saul, any of the other people that went down the wrong trail. Soften us today, Lord. Let us be able to let the tears flow. Let us be able to go to the altar today and say, oh God, forgive me, strengthen me, help me, anoint me, touch me, love me. And I thank you, Lord. Father God, I'm going to pull aside now. I did my best to convey this message. But if you cannot melt the heart of people here, Lord, of people watching, then I cannot do it either, Lord. So, Father, they're in your hands. In Jesus' name. If you're watching us and you said, I don't have anyone to pray for me. Yes, we do have people to pray for you. There's a phone number will show up. There's an address. We call people. We work with people long distance. If you're close in the area, you can come to our church. But most of all, say, my Heavenly Father, forgive me. Forgive me right now. And help me. In Jesus' name. The altars are open. Elders and deacons are here. You come. As God has been speaking to you.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person. Doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us, in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that You would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now, and I put my faith in You. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that You paid for my sins on the cross through Your shed blood, and that You died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Terrell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever.
You've been listening to Pastor John S. Terrell of Resurrection Life of Jesus Church in Sacramento, California. This message was entitled, "The Root of Bitterness." The devil has an arsenal of weapons, but bitterness is one of his choice methods of attack because it will hinder you from coming boldly to the throne of God and make you a slave to anger, resentment, and give you a desire for revenge. Pastor John shared how he has struggled with bitterness and how hidden anger would flare up every now and then when certain things happened. He attributed it to frustration and being tired, but neglected this area of his life because he thought he was fine. Pastor John showed how bitterness can come when your soul is wounded by different people, rebellion, and self-inflicted wounds, and makes you incapable of unconditional love. Fortunately, the Bible has the cure so that you can be set free and live a life without hidden anger. Remember, it's not so important how you begin your life after salvation, but how you finish it. This message is available on cassette, CD, and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1283. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can learn more about Pastor Terrell's ministry, read insightful articles, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the toll-free number in the United States is 1-888-708-3232. That's 888-708-3232. For calls from outside the U.S., the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.